So in the previous lecture, we talked about how to solve linear differential equations using homogeneous solution and particular solution approach. And then we also saw how to use convolution to solve linear differential equation. And one of the points where we were stuck in the previous lecture was this point. So what I had mentioned is we want to find the impulse response for the system. This was our system equation. Here is the impulse response delta t on the right side. And we wanted to solve this equation and we didn't quite know how to solve it. So what we did was we set the delta t. So because delta t is equal to zero everywhere, we set the right hand side to be equal to zero. And we found out how to solve this equation. Well, it turns out that this is the homogeneous solution for the differential equation, whose form is given by this expression. And I had asked you in the previous lecture to take a leap of faith and assume that A is equal to one, which is the impulse response for the system, without really justifying why the value of A here should be equal to one. So what I'm going to do today in the first few minutes is actually explain to you why the amplitude A here should be equal to one for the impulse response, okay? Let me write down the differential equation again. Dy over dt plus 2yt equals to delta t. This is the equation we want to solve. And we know that y of t should be a e raised to minus 2t. And I need to find what this value of a is equal to. So one way to solve this problem is as follows. I'm going to, so here is my y. Time, this is my y of t. And I know that y is actually zero up until time zero because there is no input. And then suddenly something happens, an impulse input is given, and then it starts decaying, the output starts decaying. So, and we want to find out what is this value A is. Okay, what this value A is for this particular system. So the way we are going to solve it is, let's assume that we want to find out why we integrate both the sides from zero minus to zero plus. Dt. Okay. So for a very small time period, so this is my zero minus, this is my zero plus. Very, very small, infinitesimally small time period, I'm doing this integration. And if you look at the first term, that first term is going to be equal to y of zero plus minus y of zero minus. What about the second term? What is this integral going to be equal to? Any thoughts? So I'm integrating 2yt dt from zero minus to zero plus. What would this integral be equal to?
Would it be two? Or maybe I'm wrong.
So why do you think it should be two? So let's say, I mean, two can come outside, that's fine. But then you have integral of yt dt. And I know that yt looks something like this. This is what yt looks like. So well, it's going to be equal to zero because this time period zero minus to zero plus is extremely small and yt is taking a finite value within this interval. So this is actually going to be equal to zero. And on the right side, remember that integral of delta t is actually equal to one, right? Because it's a unit impulse. So the right side is equal to one. And I know that y of zero minus is equal to zero because y is zero before zero. So this implies y of 0 plus is equal to 1, which means a e raised to minus 2 times 0 is equal to 1, which means a is equal to 1. Okay, so this is the proof of why a should be equal to 1. Okay, any questions? Let's go over the entire sequence of steps one more. So I wanted to solve this differential equation. I mean, delta t seems to be a pretty weird function which goes to infinity at zero and remains zero everywhere else. So what I do is I look at the homogeneous solution to this differential equation where right hand side is equal to zero. The homogeneous solution turns out to be a e raised to minus 2t. Now the question is, what's the value of a? When your input is actually an impulse input, unit impulse input. So in order to find the value of a, what we did was we integrated this differential equation from 0 minus to 0 plus. Okay, so we took the differential equation on both the sides, we multiplied by dt and we integrated from 0 minus to 0 plus. So the first integrand turns out to be y of 0 plus minus 0. The second integrand turns out to be equal to zero because the value of 2yt is finite in this interval 0 minus to 0 plus. And then the right side, delta t, turns out to be equal to 1. That's just the nature of unit impulse. You integrate it, you get 1 between 0 minus to 0 plus. So from this expression, we concluded that y of 0 plus is actually equal to 1. And then we substituted the expression for y of t from here, we substituted it here. Remember, it was a e raised to minus 2t. I substituted a e raised to minus 2 times 0. This is 0 plus. So this is the 0 you see here. And then we get a equals to 1. Okay. So what we have seen so far are two ways to solve linear differential equation. One is the particular solution and homogeneous solution method. The other one, but that requires exponential input because that sort of technique only works when you have exponential input or sinusoidal input. If you have a more general input, non-exponential, non-sinusoidal input, then you have to use convolution. And in order to use convolution, you need to compute the impulse response of the system. And we just saw how exactly you need to compute the impulse response of the system for a first order differential equation. The approach for the second and higher order differential equations are given. I mean, that particular technique is given in the book as an exercise, but we are not going to cover it in the class. You know, in a few days, we will figure out how to compute impulse response using some other method. The transfer function method, which is much easier to understand and use for day-to-day purposes. Okay. Now let's move on to the next topic, which is how do you solve linear difference equation? So the differential equation part was very, very complicated, and turns out that the linear difference equation is also similar. So the first method, which is the particular solution and homogeneous solution, works here as well. So I have this linear difference equation, summation of AK. this is the input output behavior for a linear difference equation. As was the case in the previous, in the case of differential equation, we define the so the solution to this differential equation y of n would be the sum of homogeneous solution and the particular solution. And the homogeneous solution would satisfy the following property. And then the particular solution satisfies the other condition. Yp n minus k equals to summation b kx n minus k. So the approach to solve a linear difference equation using homogeneous and particular solution would be, first find the solution, the homogeneous solution, by solving that difference equation. Find the second solution, or rather find the particular solution by solving the second equation, and then use initial condition. And one and two to compute y of n. Okay, this is exactly the approach we had taken for solving the differential equation. And it turns out that the same approach works also for difference equation. Any questions so far? Okay. Now this approach, of course, it works. I mean, you can use this approach, but the other approach is far easier to use, which is just evaluate the solution directly. So let me go over the second approach, which is the direct approach, I would say. Direct approach. This is not called the direct approach. So if you search Google direct approach, you won't find anything. It's just in my mind, this seems to be a direct approach for solving the equation. I can write y of n to be equal to one over a zero summation bkx n minus k minus So as long as you know the initial conditions and you know the values of X, like the signal X, the input X, you can just evaluate this summation and you can compute what the value of Yn is going to look like. So let's apply
this. Y on the second summation is K equal to 1 instead of 0.
Yes, that's right. K starts from 1.
But why?
Because K equals to 0 corresponds to Y of N. Do you see that?
Okay.
So I have summation of AK, Y of N minus K. K goes from 0 to N. This is A0 Yn plus...
Okay. Yep, I see that now. Thank you.
Right. Okay. Yeah. So this is what I've used here. So let's look at a simple example to get our hands dirty. My difference equation is Yn minus half Yn minus 1 equals to X of N. And let's assume that X of N, the input is actually an impulse, a scaled impulse response, impulse input. So let's write Y of N, and I'm going to assume that Y of N minus 1 is equal to 0. Sorry, no, I have to give the initial condition. So Y of minus 1 is equal to 0. Y of minus 2 is equal to 0, and so on. So let me rearrange this equation. So I have X of N plus half Y of N minus 1. Okay, so what is Y0? Y0 is equal to K delta 0 plus half Y minus 1, which is equal to K. Let's look at Yn. That's X1 plus half Y0. I've used this equation here. Now X1 is equal to 0. That's because my input is actually an impulse input, so it's active only at time 0, and rest of the time it's equal to 0. So my X1 is equal to 0. And my Y0, I just computed, it's equal to K. So I have K over 2. Maybe someone can calculate Y2 and inform us what the value of Y2 is going to look like.
K over 4.
K over 4. Let me write it as K over 2 square. For the same, like you can run the same in step, and what you get is Y of 2 is equal to K over 2 square. Y of 3 will be equal to K over 2 cube, and so on. In fact, you can show using mathematical induction that Y of N will be K over 2 raised to N. And this is what the signal, the output signal of the system is going to look like.
Question.
Yes.
Should we be using mathematical induction on homework problems, or is it sufficient just to say, just kind of look at it?
It would be better if you use induction.
Can you explain where the 2 squared came from again, please?
Okay, so let's look at y of 2. Y of 2 equals to x of 2 plus half y of 1. Now, x of 2 is equal to 0, and y of 1 is k over 2. So I get k over 2 squared.
Okay, thanks.
So in this case, what is happening, here is my system. I give it an input, which is impulse input, k delta n. I am getting an output, which is a decaying output. This is my y of n. Right, so y of n is positive throughout the entire time horizon from 0 to infinity. This kind of system is usually referred to as infinite impulse. Response system, IIR system. So you give it an impulse input, but the output is going to be infinite number of, so you will have infinite number of times in which the value is going to be positive. Output is going to be positive. So that's the meaning of IIR system. In reality, whenever you have a decaying exponential, after some time, you probably won't be able to even measure that voltage or whatever that value is going to be. So for instance, you know, if you read the, so look at the manual of any electronic item like microwave or dishwasher or something else. And they'll say, please unplug the device. Let's say you are repairing something. It'll be written, please unplug the device and wait for 2 minutes for all the charges to disappear. Now, of course, most of them are RC circuits or RL circuits. And therefore, the charges are going to dissipate only at time t equals to infinity. But for all practical purposes, within like 2 minutes or even like 30 seconds, most of the charge is dissipated. And so it's safe to touch the device after like 30 seconds or 2 minutes. But theoretically, the charge is still there and it will only decay after like infinite duration. There is a huge gap between theory and practice. Theoretically, a mathematician would say, don't touch the device for, you know, billions of years. Practically, you can test the device after 30 seconds. Okay, so next in line, I want to talk about block diagrams, which in my opinion is one of the great inventions of 1930s. If you go back in time, let's go back to 1920s or 1910s, if I have to talk about a system, I didn't know how to represent a system in a on paper. Should I draw the circuit? Should I draw the circuit diagram? Should I draw, like, I don't know, something else, like a compressor or something? And it was maybe difficult to conceptually understand, okay, what's happening in this whole system. And so some people came up with this idea of block diagram, where you can represent systems with blocks, and you can represent the signals from just arrows, and how the arrows flow from one subsystem to another basically represents how the signals are changing, or what signal, what output signal is becoming the input signal of its subsystem. So that's what block diagram does. And let's say we have a system whose difference equation is given by something like this. How do I represent this system on a paper? And it turns out that this is how we would represent it. So let's look at y of n equals to bxn minus ayn minus 1. So I have the system x of n. I have the output as y of n. And in order to compute the output y of n, I have to amplify the input by b. So I'm going to multiply it by b. So this is just amplification. Then I have to subtract the previous value of y multiplied by a. So this d is a delay. D stands for delay. So I'm just delaying the signal by one time step. So yn goes into this delay loop. Sorry, the arrow should be in the other direction. So yn enters the delay loop, and out comes y of n minus 1. So one step. It holds the value of yn for one time step, and then outputs that. Gets multiplied by a, goes and gets added here. And this is exactly the value of y of n. So this is the block diagram. So there are a few ways by which you can understand some of the building blocks of block diagram. So let's talk about that. Any questions so far on this block diagram? We'll learn about each of these blocks. What does it mean? Okay, so the building blocks of block diagram are as follows. So you have signal x1n, and you have signal x2n. You get x1 plus x1n plus x2n. So this is addition. So this is subtraction. So you put a negative sign. Put a negative sign here to demonstrate that, I screwed up. There should be a negative sign here. So minus x1n plus x2n, or x2 minus x1. That's the output of this particular block. We just put a negative sign right next to that arrow where it's adding to that, to this plus block. Then amplification. Amplified by A. So there are two ways to show it. One is just by writing on top of the arrow. The other is by putting a block around it. Because typically in circuits, you would do a lot of amplification or reduction in the amplitude. So it's sometimes easier to just write A on top of the arrow rather than making a complete block. But both of these are synonymous in the block diagram world.
I have a question.
Yes.
In 2050, we used something that was like a circle with an X through it for like
that was multiplication. Yeah, that would be multiplication.
Okay.
Yeah.
That different from amplification?
No, that's, you can do the same thing. Yeah, there are just various ways to denote multiplication.
All right, cool. Thank you.
And then the third one is delay or differential. So okay, so the delay block would just store the input for 1 second and then output it at the next time step. In the case of differential, it just takes the derivative of the input signal. One of the things you need to be, so if you're working on an actual system, typically doing the differentiation of raw signals is very, very complicated because signals may have noise embedded in it. You know, sometimes it's the thermal noise, sometimes it's some other form of noise, acoustic noise or something like that. And so these noises would lead to very high output, even though the underlying signal itself may not have a very high value of differentiation. So one has to be very careful when you are doing this differential operator in the real world system. Because you don't want to amplify noise by taking the differentiation of noise. Okay, and then the integral. Typically, this is used in continuous time, denoted by just an integral sign. And this is integral of xd dt minus x tau d tau. These are various blocks that forms the building block of representing systems in a very compact form on paper. Okay. So we saw an application of these blocks when we constructed this particular block for this system equation. Now let's try to do the same thing for a differential equation, linear differential equation. So I'm looking for a linear differential equation. Someone wants to suggest a linear differential equation. Some just come up with some arbitrary linear differential equation. Okay, no one wants to say anything. Let me pick one just out of the blue. I don't know, 5 dy over dt plus 6yt equals to xt plus 100 dx over dt. Now the goal is for us to show this using a block diagram. So let's look at it. I have y of t equals to 1 over 6 x of t plus 100 dx over dt minus Okay, so I have this differential equation. Looks pretty bad. But let's see how to do it. Let's represent this in a block diagram. So I have an input coming as xt. Let me take a branch out, pass it through the differential operator, multiply it by 100, add the two things. So I get xt plus 100 dx over dt. That's the output here. Then I'm going to add additional one over six. So this one over six comes here. Now y of t, so I have negative d2y over dt square. So I can pass it over two blocks, two differential blocks. And then I have 5 dy over dt. So I'll pass it with one differential, multiply it by 5. And add it up here. Oh, and then I have to put a negative sign. Don't forget this negative sign. Let's do the matching. This negative sign comes here. This negative sign comes here. The second derivative comes here, the first derivative comes here, and then this 1 over 6 is given. Okay, so we have now represented the system through a block diagram.
What would you recommend us do if we have an equation that has both a differential and a delay, since we use the capital D for both of those symbols?
Oh, so the delay is for discrete time and the D used for continuous time is differential, for D used in discrete time is delay. Now, I think what you mean is,
okay.
What you mean is the other form of delay. So you have like delta T minus T naught. And so you pass XT and your output is X of T minus T naught.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. So this would be like a, I don't know, a delay operator. No, this would be X of T naught, sorry. Yeah, this is the sampling. This would be the sampling of the signal. Yeah, but there are systems where there are delays in the continuous time itself because, you know, the like in air conditioning system, you turn on the AC, but it's not like it starts pumping heat right away. It takes like a couple of minutes to warm up and then starts pumping heat. So that sort of delay operator, it has to be then specified that, well, this is a delay in a continuous time system appropriately in the block. So I don't think this would work. This will not work. It's not a delay operator, the delta operator. You have to write it as D, but somehow make sure that it's clear that it's D in continuous time, not in discrete time. Okay, so I think with that, we are end of chapter two. There is one section on singularity functions, but we are not covering that. Singularity functions is part of this course. It's just some mathematical stuff that you can read up if you are interested in some mathematical mumbo jumbo of signals and systems. We'll start with chapter three. Let me just cover some of the basic stuff of chapter three, and then we'll start talking about Fourier series in the next class. Just a couple of announcements. So on next Monday, we have quiz one, and quiz one covers everything we have covered so far. So quiz one will not cover Fourier series. It will only cover up to the block diagram, so up to whatever we have done so far. Fourier series would be a completely different topic now, and that'll be covered in quiz two, not in quiz one. And in fact, assignment three is uploaded, and assignment three also covers everything until the solution to linear differential equation and block diagram. It doesn't cover the Fourier series. Oh, yeah, I will have. So there's a question, will I post solutions after homework three? Yes, I'll definitely post solutions. For homework one and two, I'll post it this week itself, and homework three, I'll post it right after homework three is over. Okay.
I have a quick question about the quiz.
Yes, go ahead.
Any more details about it? Like, I'm assuming, like you mentioned earlier, we only have one class period to do it, but do you know, can you tell us like how long or how many questions is on it?
So actually that's a good question. So usually I'll have like 10 questions, true, false, multiple choice, you know, things like that. And typically my philosophy is you should get 3 to 5 times more time than what I would take to solve the quiz. Or whatever, so solve the final exam or midterm exam or whatever. So you are getting 55 minutes to solve the quiz. So I should be able to complete the quiz from 11 minutes to like 20 minutes or so. No, 20 minutes is too much. 15 minutes. Roughly from 11 minutes to 15 minutes, I should be able to finish the quiz on my own. So that's what it's going to be like. I think it'll be about 10 questions. It's a 10 marks quiz. So there'll be 10 questions. Some of them will be true, false. Some of them will be multiple choice and so on. And I will be able to solve all the questions on the quiz correctly in 11 to 15 minutes. Does that help?
Yeah, thank you.
Great. Okay. Any other question about the quiz or assignment? No? Okay. So we've talked about LTI systems. And we have seen how to solve for a given input, how do you compute the output of the LTI system? Now it turns out, and we will see shortly, that in an LTI system, let's say you have a continuous time system and you give it an input, a complex exponential signal, e raised to st, turns out that the output of the LTI system is going to be e raised to st multiplied by a complex function, h of, not a function, but just a complex number, h of s, capital H of s. And for the LTI system, we will refer to H of S as the eigenvalue. Okay, so what does it like? So one of the questions you may ask is, how does it relate to the eigenvalues and eigenvectors you might have studied in the context of linear algebra? And if you think about it, in the linear algebra case, let's say you give an input V, you have a matrix multiplied A, and the output is lambda V. So AV equals to lambda V. And what do we say? Well, V is the eigenvector and lambda is the eigenvalue of the matrix A. And that's the same analogy that I'm making in the case of LTI system. I give it an input e raised to st. The output turns out a amplified version of e raised to st. And the amplification factor is h of s, just like the amplification factor here is lambda. And so H of S is called eigenvalue of the LTI system. And V is the same as e raised to st. And V is called the eigenvector in the case of linear algebra. And in the case of general LTI systems, it's called the eigenfunction of the LTI system. Okay, so that's the analogy here. Now let's look at why this should be the case. So if I have an LTI system, why would an exponential input lead to an exponential output? Let's look at it. Let's say H of t is the impulse response of the system, and I want to compute what Y of t is going to look like. So I know you are all dying to tell me that this is actually a convolution. H of tau e raised to s t minus tau d tau. Okay. So why is it a convolution equation? Well, this is where the LTI system, the property of the system being an LTI system, is being used. So because it's an LTI system, I can write the output in terms of integral of in terms of a convolution integral. Now, because the input is complex exponential, I can break e raised to st minus tau into e raised to st e raised to minus s tau d tau. And this is where the input being exponential is being used. Now you all will recognize that e raised to st doesn't participate in the integral because it's not a function of tau. So I can take this e raised to st outside. And what I am left with is the function h of s. This thing in the block is h of s. Okay, so I've used the property of LTI system and I've used the property of input being exponential to show that to an LTI system, you give a complex exponential input. The output that you get is some complex number h of s. This is the complex number h of s, which gets multiplied by the input e raised to st. Okay. We can do the same thing for any questions so far before I jump onto the discrete time system. Okay, easy to understand. Let's look at the discrete time system. The complex exponential input in discrete time would be z raised to n. H of k or h of n. And I want to find out what y of n is going to look like. And this whole block is actually h of z. So once again, in discrete time, a complex exponential input will get transformed into complex exponential multiplied by an amplification factor h of z. Okay, so that's just a very, very special property of an LTI system with an exponential input. And we will leverage this property to talk about Fourier series representation of periodic signals in the next class. That's all I have. I'm going to stop the recording. And then if you have any questions, feel free to ask me.